Having a JTAG interface that's always reliable is a fundamental requirement of any boundary scan test system. But how do you confirm communication to the JTAG devices is going to be robust? That's where the JTAG Chain Debugger application comes in. And in this short video, I'll show you how to get the most from it. Click the Check Chain button down here at the bottom of the screen to get things running. The software now performs a sequence of tests. In case the system has any signal integrity or noise problems, it runs first at a low T-clock frequency to confirm the JTAG chain works. And if everything's okay, it then continues at higher speed. AutoSkew, by the way, which runs both here at the beginning and again at the faster speed, is a feature that ensures the received TDO waveform is consistently sampled at the optimal point. It compensates for the delays of any buffers in the chain, as well as the effects of the cable and response time of the devices themselves. AutoSkew works by forcing a change in TDO and measuring how many fractions of a clock pulse it takes before the transition is seen. It then uses this delay to calculate the optimal time to sample TDO for all future readings. Once your test reset sequence has been used to initialize the devices, the test starts by counting the number of JTAG ICs in the chain, which it does by seeing how many bypass registers it can find. They're always one bit long, so that tells it how many devices there are. If that doesn't match what you know is on the board, you'll need to investigate. One point worth noting is that there can be valid reasons for reporting more ID codes than there are devices on the board. A multi-core IC, for instance, may show up as more than one device, so a mismatch isn't necessarily a fault. If the communication is working, it now performs an auto-skew optimization ready to read the registers. Still at slow speed, the software reads the ID codes of your devices. If the number of ID codes it reads matches the number of devices it previously counted, it will report that the chain is intact. If the routine reaches this point without problems, the software knows your chain runs okay at 100 kHz, so now increases the clock frequency, typically to 1 MHz, and performs a fresh auto-skew for this higher speed. By the way, you can alter the frequency it runs at if you need to by changing the figure in the box at the bottom of the screen. With the chain now running at this faster rate, the software checks it can still see the correct number of devices and measures the total length of all the instruction registers in the chain. The next thing it wants to do is to measure the length of each device's sample register, but to do that, it must put the other ICs into bypass mode, for which it needs to know more about their instruction registers. The software therefore searches your library for BSDL files with ID codes that match what it read from the devices. If it finds files for them all, it will also use the data to confirm the earlier measurement of the sum of instruction register lengths was correct. If it doesn't find matching BSDL files, you'll be asked to locate them and add them to the library. If it finds more than one per device, which can occur if the silicon is available in different packages, you'll need to select which one to use. Once it has the data it requires, it will attempt to measure the length of each device's sample register and will confirm if they match what's stated in the BSDL files. The test is then complete, and if there were no errors, you know your chain's basic functionality and communication is okay. It may be you get errors that need to be resolved, of course, in which case, if your circuit contains multiple chains, the software will try them separately to see if any of them will work. If a chain works correctly at the initial slow speed but fails at high speed, there's likely to be a problem with signal integrity. So check things like grounding, termination resistors, and crosstalk, which we considered in the first video of this series. On the other hand, if a test fails early on, for instance, being unable to read an ID code, the issue probably lies with the physical connections. And you may also want to refer to the video on DC checks. While you're debugging, if you need to trace the JTAG signals through your circuit with a scope, you might find a software feature called scan ID codes helpful because it keeps those signals running continually. I'll be demonstrating that tool in the next video. On the other hand, if everything's fine and the chain tests have passed, the next step is to check that your board can run at the required speed. To do that, take a look at video 6 in the series, which deals with using getMaxTClock. Thank you for watching. If you found this video helpful, please subscribe for more and leave a like or comment below.